last function is the secant, inverse secant function. And again, let's recall the basic graph of the secant function. If you remember, the way we graphed the secant function was we looked at the graph of the cosine function, right? And then we took the reciprocals of these values, and that's why they went like that, okay? From, if this is 1, the lowest value is 1 over here, and then it goes all the way up to infinity. And then here it's negative 1, the highest value down here is negative 1, and then it goes all the way down to negative infinity, okay? So we said that, well, again, for secant, we saw that they're asymptotes, okay? And the asymptotes are, again, like the asymptotes of the tangent function, because it's over cosine, right? Secant is the reciprocal of cosine. So this function is y equals secant x. 1 over cosine of x. So cosine is 0, but odd multiples of pi over 2. So therefore, we say here that the domain is all real numbers except 2n plus 1, pi over 2, where n is an integer. So all the odd multiples of pi over 2, okay? Or, so we say that these are the asymptotes of the graph, okay, of the secant function. And the range, we say that, well, it's what? It's negative infinity to negative 1, union 1 to infinity. So it's the same story as before. We want to invert the function. However, it's not 1 to 1. So we just want to choose pieces, okay? In other words, we want to restrict the domain in such a way that we can still grab all of the range, okay? So the range will be from 1 to infinity, as well as from negative infinity to negative 1. And I think you will agree that, and this is where some books have a different way of doing it, but I agree with the way this book does it. It's easier to do it the way, in such a way that, and you'll see later when I summarize what the unit circles will look like. We'll choose this in such a way that it's kind of like the same range or the same restriction in the domain that we did for the reciprocal function, okay? Remember, for a cosine function, what we did was we took the interval 0 to pi, and you can rewind that, or as I said, I'll summarize later, okay? For secant, we do the same thing. We choose the interval 0 to pi. However, you notice that at pi over 2, the secant function is undefined, so there will be some gap there, some hole, okay? So if we look at this portion and this portion, okay, we have restricted the domain 0 to pi, not including pi over 2. And at the same time, we're able to grab all the answers for the range, okay? We have all the answers from 1 to infinity, all the answers from negative infinity to negative 1, or from negative 1 down, okay? So that's the restriction. So then if you look at your inverse, so then, therefore, now you will put this here. Your x will now be the negative 1, 1, right? And then here you'll have your pi over 2. Well, actually, what am I doing? I'll have the pi over 2 to pi. Yeah, this is what I need to do. Sorry. Okay, so let me lower this. So this is pi over 2, and this is pi. Okay, so because when we flip this, imagine this will become the y and that's the x, okay? So let's see what I will have here. At pi over 2, you have, what am I, it's an asymptote, okay? Maybe I'm getting tired. Okay, you have an asymptote at pi over 2, it's a horizontal asymptote. Theta is 0, okay? When the theta is 0, cosine is 1, so secant is 1. So there you go, I have that, okay? So I'll start here, okay? And as I approach pi over 2, I will go this way. And then when we have, let's say, pi, you'll have negative 1, so I'll be here. And then I think it goes that way, okay? So that's what we have. Let me see if that's what I have on my shirt. Yeah, I guess so. Okay, so yeah, I have that here. All right, so for secant, this is the second thing on my shirt. All right, so that's the kind of graph that you have. So basically what I did was I inverted this, okay? And see how it's, for me at least, I don't know about you, I find it harder to remember this than for me to remember the unit circle, that if I want the inverse of secant, so by the way, this is now secant inverse of x. Or again, you can write this as arc secant x, okay? So if I want this, rather than think of this graph, I personally would rather think of this, okay? But now I put a hole at pi over 2, okay? Because pi over 2, it's not defined there. Secant is not defined there, okay? And the same story, if I my argument of secant inverse is positive, I look at the first quadrant. When the argument is negative, I look at the second quadrant. And this was what I was explaining earlier. If you go back to the video for the inverse for cosine, cos inverse or arc cosine, this was the exact same interval that we took, okay? 0 to pi, except of course for cosine there were no holes, okay? Because cosine was defined for the entire interval, all right? So that's the story for the inverse secant. And yeah, I guess, well, let me give you an example. Erase the board. So here you'll see the nice thing about choosing the interval, okay, for the restriction to be the same as the interval for cosine, because like here, if I have secant inverse of 2, I can really readily just put an equal sign and say, okay, I don't want to think of secant, I want to think of cos inverse, okay? And the cos inverse of, if secant inverse of 2 is really the same as cos inverse of a half, okay? And that's the beauty of this thing, is I don't have to worry about, well, maybe I'm going to go to the a wrong quadrant, okay? So hopefully we all know what a half is. The arc whose cosine is a half is pi over 3, right? Pi over 3, that's in the first quadrant. So you have that, okay? Likewise, if your question is, and again, let me put this notation. If, let's say, I want the arc secant of, let's say, negative 2, then I can just put an equal sign and say, okay, instead of thinking of this, let me just think of the arc secant of negative a half. All right? And then you know that it's the multiple of pi over 3 in the second quadrant, so that is 2 pi over 3. Okay? And that's what you do. You can actually just flip-flop. All right? Oh, sorry, I wrote this wrong. This should be arc cosine of negative 1 half, right? So that's the arc cosine of negative 1 half, which is 2 pi over 3. Okay? Let's see. Yeah, and same thing with the other. So if you want, let's say, secant inverse of the other one is the reciprocal of root 3 over 2 is 2 over root 3. 2 root 3 over 3, okay? And let's say you want that negative to make it ugly, okay? If you can't think of this, then you can get the reciprocal of this and just think of cos inverse of the reciprocal of this. So when you rationalize that, that's going to be root 3 over 2, okay? Negative root 3 over 2. So hopefully you can figure that out faster than looking at this, okay? So cos inverse of root 3 over 2 without the negative, you know that that's going to be a multiple of pi over 6, right? Okay, so it's pi over 6. However, it's negative, so I want the multiple of pi over 6 in the second quadrant. I know it's pi over 6 in the first, so in the second quadrant, in order to get that multiple, I just subtract pi over 6 from pi, right? So pi minus pi over 6 is 5 pi over 6, okay? So that's the nice thing about choosing that range to be the same as the range for arc cosine, okay?